Wake Up America, time to stump the experts. Each week at this time, the H.J. Heinz Company, makers of the famous 57 varieties, gives you information, please. A quartet of experts is on hand to answer your questions. Send them to Information Please at 570 Lexington Avenue, New York City. We may edit them a bit, and in case of similarity, you'll have to accept our judgment of who shall be paid. If we use your question, the H.J. Heinz Company will send $10 in war stamps plus a set of the 12-volume Britannica Junior Encyclopedia. If we muff the question, you get $57 in war bonds and stamps plus a 24-volume set of the regular Encyclopedia Britannica. All questions remain our property. Information, Please is presented under the supervision of Dan Golenpaul. And now, our master of ceremonies, book reviewer of the New Yorker magazine, Clifton Fadiman.
Thank you, Mr. Brower. Ladies and gentlemen, spontaneous as ever, Information Please presents tonight the veteran trio, Oscar Levant, Franklin P. Adams, and John Kieran of the New York Sun, who welcome as their guest the world-famous conductor and author of the charming autobiography, A Mingled Chime, Sir Thomas Beecham. We're going to begin with a question that comes to us from Attleboro, Massachusetts, thought up by Fred Abbott. Mr. Abbott wants to know, what plays took place in whole or in part in each of these places? In other words, these are the settings. Let's get two out of three. The first setting is the Wartburg.
What?
The Wartburg, W-A-R-T-B-U-R-G, Sir Thomas.
Tannhäuser.
Tannhäuser, no question about that. What play took place in part at the Hotel de Bourgogne? Hotel de Bourgogne, Mr. Kieran.
Cyrano de Bergerac.
That's quite right. And what one took place in part, I guess wholly, at 480 Madison Avenue. 480 Madison Avenue. Mr. Levant.
Well, the Days lived on Madison Avenue.
Keep going.
But I don't think it was on 480.
Oh, yes, it was, unless they've moved.
Well, that's Life with Father.
Life with Father. Did you think they'd moved?
Well, I don't know.
The play hasn't.
I haven't been asked there lately.
Life with Father is quite correct. Yes, the play by Lindsay and Krauss, made out of Clarence Day's essays. That's right, isn't it, Mr. Adams? You're an old Madison Avenue. Well, how about this one from Helen W. Traver of Hartford, Connecticut? This is a musical question, gentlemen. Each of these musical excerpts that you're going to hear should suggest to you some form of magic. Tell us about it. Let's have the first. Mr. Adams?
That is sorcery.
Yes. What?
John Wallington Wells.
Yes. What does he do?
He's a sorcerer.
Yes, and he deals in what?
Magic and spells.
That's quite right. In blessings and curses.
Ever-filled purses.
Yes.
Prophecies, witches, and nellies.
Quite right, Sir Thomas. Yes. You are putting Mr. Adams to shame.
Oh, no, he knew it. He always leaves something for me.
Yes, that is about... it's from the sorcerer, Gilbert and Sullivan's operetta, of course. How about the second bit of magic? I have both musicians' hands, Mr. Levant.
That's the magic fire music in the last act of Valkyr.
Yes, tell us a little about that. What happened?
Brunhilde disobeyed her father, Wotan, who only had one eye in the middle of his head, order when she interceded in a censorable romance between Sigalinda and Sigmund in the first act. So as a punishment, she is shielded by fire for as many years as a pure hero can break through and get her to wake up and sing for 3 hours in the last act of Siegfried.
I wonder what you would do if you ever heard of punctuation, Levant. That is a perfect answer, despite the syntax. And now the third and last. Mr. Levant?
That's Deems Taylor's The Sorcerer's Apprentice by Dukas.
Does he have a stranglehold?
Well, he was in that picture by Disney.
Yes. And what happens in The Sorcerer's Apprentice as that music is played?
There's a broom. Who the master orders to bring some water, and he overdoes it. The broom overdoes it, and then he cuts the broom in half, and more water comes, and before I know it, you're like Hitler in those two dams.
Right, sir. Try this one from Mrs. M.B. Hickson of Minneapolis. Of what season was the poet thinking when he wrote the following phrases? The first is, the only pretty ring time. Sir Thomas.
Spring.
Spring is right. And can you prove it with a quotation?
Yes. The only pretty ring time. We lovers love the spring.
Yes. It's from what play?
Mr. Kieran?
It's an interpolated song in As You Like It.
Yes, that's quite right. Maxine Sullivan recently made it very popular as a beautiful song. Oh, so, Thomas, who wrote the music that we associate with that song now? Do you know?
I think On.
Who did?
On.
How do you spell him?
A-R-N-E.
Okay, I just wanted to know. Here's another phrase. The light that loses, the night that wins. Refers to what season of the year, Mr. Kieran?
When the hounds of spring are in winter's traces, and the mother of months in meadow and plain fills the hollow, and that's enough.
Oh, no. But
Swinburne.
That's quite right. The light that loses, the night that wins, the days dividing lover and lover. From what poem of Swinburne?
Well, it's a chorus from Atalanta and
Calydon. It's one of the most magnificent of Swinburne's choruses. And finally, what season does this remind you of? Sing Cuckoo. Sing Cuckoo. Mr. Levan.
The first cuckoo in spring by Sir Thomas Beecham's protege, Delius. Is that right?
That's a very graceful response. I hadn't thought of that. But the actual phrase, sing cuckoo, is used in a poem about what season?
Not spring, I guess.
Not
summer
spring.
Summer is coming in.
Yes. Isn't it the first poem that usually occurs in the anthology?
It's the first poem that was set to written music in English language and English notes.
And what does the phrase mean, summer is coming in?
Well,
summer is coming in.
Summer's arriving.
No. That's where you're wrong, gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure to correct you, which rarely happens. Summer is a coming in means summer has come in. It's the Middle English.
That's right.
It's the perfect of the verb. Did you know that, Sir Thomas?
Do you know the companion piece to it? Winter is a coming in.
You're just trying to get off the subject, Sir Thomas. However, I'd like to know about the companion piece.
Winter is a coming in. Loud sing, God damn.
Never heard of it. In fact, I haven't heard you at the moment. Marguerite House of Asheville, North Carolina. And by the way, gentlemen, it would be a pleasure to the Secretary of the Treasury if you would flop on a couple of these questions. Miss House of Asheville wants you to prepare a 3-course dinner in the proper order of the courses, made up of foods mentioned in Proverbs that you're to quote. Now, don't give us quotations from poetry unless the quotation has become as well known as a proverb, Mr. Kieran.
Too many cooks spoil the broth.
Very good. And that gives us soup broth to begin with. Broth is right. And Mr. Levant.
Don't cook the ghost that killed the golden egg or something like that. Well, you got egg there.
Well, you've got eggs and you've got goose and you've got sauce. No, you haven't sauce.
As like as two peas.
As like as two peas for our vegetable course, Mr. Adams.
And in my salad days.
Yes, that's very good. And for dessert, can you think of any? Mr. Adams?
24 blackbirds baked in a pie.
Well, it isn't a proverb exactly. Mm-hmm. I will never desert Mr. Micawber, Sir Thomas might do.
Ice cream for ice cream by Eddie Cannon.
Never heard. It's not a proverb, is it?
It's a poem which you got a lot of money for.
All right. That gives us at least 4 courses.
Cherry ripe.
Cherry ripe, yes. Don't cry over spilt milk if we have to have a beverage. How about this one for Mrs. S.H. Stewart of Warren, Ohio? What work of art, gentlemen, was created for the following reasons? In the first case, the painter wanted to disprove a theory. And so he created a work of art for the purpose of disproving a theory. Who was that and what was the painting?
Salvatore Dali. He does it every day.
He doesn't disprove a theory. He proves theories with his painting. Mr. Kieran, what were you going to say?
Do you mean Whistler?
No. But tell me about Whistler.
Oh, he disproved all the theories. He tried to disprove all the theories that the other painters had.
Well, this is a very specific theory in painting.
A guess. Rousseau?
No. The answer is Gainsborough's famous painting of the Blue Boy. Sir Joshua Reynolds, who was a great muck-a-muck critic of that time, and George Romney held that an artist couldn't paint an all-blue picture that had any merit. And to prove that it could be done, Gainsborough painted the Blue Boy. It's become rather famous since then. Mr. Adams, this is new to you?
New to me.
It was new to me a couple of minutes ago, too. Pardon?
Constable.
The constable did the same thing?
Up to the time of Constable. You could not have a picture in it where there was not a brown tree.
Where there was not a brown tree.
Brown tree. And Constable painted a landscape without a brown tree.
Very well, then. Yet that answer would have been equally good. Mm-hmm. How about this one? The author wanted to entertain a little girl, and as a result created a work of art. What work, Sir Thomas?
Alice in Wonderland.
Alice in Wonderland by Lewis Carroll, quite right. That's the origin of it. And in what case was a work of art created because the composer's wife
suspected him of an infidelity. And to answer the charge, he created, composed something. Who was that and what was the work?
A musical work?
Yes, it was.
Very few composers have been accused of infidelity. You overestimate them. Although, Mozart, I don't think so. He felt that way about his wife, who didn't compose.
Yes, but he certainly didn't create any work of art.
Berlioz?
No.
Wagner?
No, Richard Strauss was thought...
Didn't know.
His wife thought that he was guilty of a peccadillo, and he wasn't, as a matter of fact. And
is that the Domestica Symphony?
No.
No.
It was an operetta, I think, called Intermezzo.
Intermezzo.
Is that right, Sir Thomas?
Yes, quite right.
Does it come back to you now?
Yes.
Well, let's see.
But it wasn't an infidelity. It was only a flirtation.
Ah, yes. Well, we exaggerate on this program. Guess see, we got two...
There's a vast difference in my country.
There is a vast difference. That's two wrong out of three, and that sends a $57 in war bonds and stamps to Mrs. Stewart and a set of the Britannica. And now we have a timely question. Who started Memorial Day? Ben Grauer, our Heinz reporter, has a likely gleam in his eye. How about it, Mr. Grauer?
Now, this day, originally known as Decoration Day, was started exactly 75 years ago in 1868 by order of General Logan, commander-in-chief of the GAR. Of course, there are other Memorial Days celebrated somewhat earlier in many southern states. And it's rather an interesting fact that this old American institution of Memorial Day began only 1 year before another well-known American institution, the House of Hinds. 74 crowded years have gone by since young Henry J. Hinds planted, harvested, and grated the crop from a 3/4-acre patch of horseradish roots. The principle upon which Henry J. Hinds started in business has never been lost sight of. He believed in using only the best possible ingredients, preferably those he raised himself. He saw to it that cooking was done in a clean, shining kitchen with grand old home recipes. So way back then, housewives welcomed the help that Hinds Foods could give them. Now today, they need this help more than ever. Ask any woman who wrestles with a ration book. And we're mighty glad that despite war conditions, there are still so many Hinds 57 varieties on your grocer's shelf to help make wartime meals the easier to plan and cook and the better to eat.
Thank you, Mr. Grauer. We'll go on with a question from Arthur Mendel of New York City. And this, too, is a musical question. We're going to ask you to identify these familiar orchestral works just from the openings of the second violin parts. Is the problem clear? Well, let's have the first. Mr. Levant and Sir Thomas both have their hands up. Mr. Levant first.
It's Mendelssohn, is it? I mean, unfinished symphony of
Sir
Schubert.
Sir Thomas?
Schubert.
First movement of the unfinished.
Yes, the first movement of the unfinished. What made you say Mendelssohn?
Because I had the right melody in my mind, and I'm a confused fella. It goes back a long way.
Nevertheless, you were right, Oscar, on the second try, the unfinished symphony of Schubert, and now the second.
That's the Brahms, First Symphony, the introduction.
Is that right, Sir Thomas?
Might be.
Yes, it is. That's right.
Very good.
Yes, Mr. Levant, exactly right. And now the third and last of the second violin excerpts. That isn't much to go by.
Thomas conducts this brilliantly.
But then he's too modest to tell us what it is.
Well,
I suppose you do.
Till Eulenspiegel.
Come back to you now, Sir Thomas. Quite right, yes. Good work. That gives us 3 out of 3 and sends us on to a question from Stephen G. Pratt of Philadelphia. Give the familiar quotations that contain these phrases. All of these phrases have the word ill in them, I-L-L. The first is ill at ease. Ill at ease, Mr. Adams.
That's from the Lost Chord.
It is from the Lost
Chord.
Seated
one day at my organ, I was weary and ill at ease.
Beautiful. Simply beautiful. That's quite right. I don't think there's any other phrase in which it appears. At least I hope not, if you're going to sing it.
Music is by Sullivan.
The music is by Sullivan. Who wrote the words?
Adelaide Ann Proctor.
I wouldn't know. That's right. Adelaide Ann Proctor.
Quite right.
Right, Sir Thomas?
Yes.
How about this one? Ill Woodwind. Ill Woodwind. Mr. Levant.
Ill Woodwind.
Mm. Puzzling, isn't it?
Very familiar, but...
It blows nobody any good.
Oh, no, that's not quite right, Mr.
Mr. Adams. Thought.
Mr. Adams?
That's what I thought. It's an ill woodwind.
It's an oboe.
It blows nobody good.
Now, you've got everything right with the order of the words.
Isn't that a woodwind, an oboe?
Yes, it's an oboe. An ill woodwind that nobody blows good.
Yeah, well, you have the paraphrase in front of you.
You're quite right. Yes, it's a definition of an oboe.
Some of my best friends are bad oboe players.
Sir Thomas, what does the word oboe come from? It seems a funny
word. Au bois.
Meaning what?
A high instrument made of wood.
And is it the same as our word hobo?
H-A-U-T-B-O-Y.
High boy.
High boy. Is it the same as hobo, John?
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
same derivation.
Itinerant, yeah. Vagrant, and so forth. Same derivation. All mixed up together. Do you think you got that right, Mr. Adams, and when you said an ill woodwind that blows nobody any good?
If it's wrong,
I'd
said
rather
it wrong.
Give the.
You want credit for getting it wrong, Oscar? Okay.
Naturally, I did it with my hatchet.
All right, so you can get the next one. The next ill, and the last ill, is ill favored. Mr. Kieran.
An ill favored thing, sir, but my own.
That's perfect, except for the word my.
Mine own.
Yes.
Mine own.
What's
that
it from, Mr. Kieran?
That is said by Touchstone in As You Like It.
Yes, and...
About the young lady he is not trying very hard to marry.
Yes, that's putting it very nicely. That's quite right. An ill-favored thing, sir, but mine own. That gives us 2 out of 3. Try
Audrey.
This from Walter Munfried of Milwaukee.
Little Audrey.
Little Audrey. Identify these literary series. So, Thomas, what would be the plural of series?
Series.
Same thing.
Series. Series would be wrong. I thought it would be rather a singular plural. How about this one? The action of one volume, the action of one volume takes place in Queen Anne's England and the other in pre-revolutionary Virginia. What are the two books, Sir Thomas?
The Virginians.
That's one of them. And what's the one that precedes
Esmond.
It? Esmond. Esmond, yes, both by William Makepeace Thackeray. That's quite right. One play describes the candidate's election and first term. The sequel describes his defeat and a burlesque revolution. Mr. Levant.
The I sing and let him eat cake.
That's quite right, Mr. Levant. The first play is set at the time of creation. The second in the series is set at the present time. The third in the year 31,920. Sir Thomas.
Back to Methuselah.
Yes, by George Bernard Shaw. Quite right, Back to Methuselah. That was too easy. Here's one from Floyd Cooper of Amarillo, Texas. What lies between these terminal points? John O'Groat's house and Land's End. Mr. Kieran.
The whole of England and Scotland.
And?
Wales.
Yes. Where is John O'Groat's house?
John O'Groat's is the extreme northerly part, and Land's End is the extreme southwesterly part known as Cornwall or Dark Valerium.
Yes. Northeast of Scotland to the southwest of England. That's quite right. What lies between these terminal points? North Adams and Greenfield. Mr. North Adams.
Well, that's in Massachusetts.
Yes.
Both of them.
That's right. And
one is the... one is the western part of Massachusetts. North Adams, the eastern, is the western part of Massachusetts.
Well, Frank doesn't know what you want. He knows.
What lies between them? What runs from one to the other?
Go ahead.
Mr. Kieran.
The Mohawk Trail.
Yes, the famous Mohawk Trail. did I not make myself
that.
Clear, Mr. Adams?
I didn't know that.
Oh, yes, you did.
No, I didn't. Oh, I haven't driven a car in years.
Who has? What is a car? What lies between heaven and Hoboken? Between heaven and Hoboken?
Taxes.
Between heaven and Hoboken, why, Mr. Kieran? Yeah, and you a veteran of the early World War.
Well, yes, that's coming back from the World War, and heaven or another destination in Hoboken, it was used in both directions.
Yes, yes, that's right. Heaven, hell, or Hoboken, that's the slogan of the soldiers in the First World War. That's quite right. Well, that gives us 3 out of 3. And now here's our Heinz reporter, Ben Grauer, in one of his more nostalgic moods.
Holidays carry us back in memory to the years that have gone before. And maybe you recall earlier decoration days, parading with your schoolmates down the streets of your town under the bright new green of the maples. Remember the feel of your tight Sunday best shoes. And most of all, you remember a picnic. When you think of a picnic, your thoughts naturally turn to Heinz 57 varieties. You think of pickles, don't you? Cool, crisp, and spicy. Mustard, too. India relish, chopped even as can be and seasoned with rare exotic spices brought from the Orient. You think of jellies glimmering like jewels in the glass and rich brown apple butter. Heinz ketchup, chili sauce, and 57 sauce to add that final zip of perfection to a hot dog grilled on the open fire. Well, this summer, most of us will take our outings in our backyards or pretty close at home, but picnics will still be picnics. And we can assure you of a good supply of Heinz 57 varieties to make your picnic lunches tempting as all outdoors.
Thank you, Ben. And Adams, by the way, isn't going to eat his words this week, I feel sure. I've never seen him look so hungry. Try this one from Mrs. L.F. Bustler, Jr. of Memphis, Tennessee. This is all about prisoners, famous prisoners of fact or fiction. Who are they? The first was the prisoner of his brother, Mr. Levant.
The Iron Mask.
That's the fellow, the man in the Iron Mask. Quite right. Isn't that right, Mr. Kieran?
Both
quite
played by Louis Hayward.
That's how you found out. Mr. Kieran, what is the story of the man in the Iron Mask?
History hasn't confirmed the truth of this.
Should we drop the whole subject?
It's still a mystery.
It's in the Dumas series, the Vicomte de Bragelon.
There is one, the man in the Iron Mask.
That's the Iron Lung.
Well, as you say, Mr. Adams, there is still a mystery about it, but according to one account, according to one version, the man in the Iron Mask was the twin brother of Louis, whom their father concealed and imprisoned. Is that right?
That's Dumas' story.
That's Dumas' story, and let's stick to it. How about one who was the prisoner of her cousin? The prisoner of her cousin, Sir Thomas?
Mary, Queen of Scots.
Yes, imprisoned by...
Elizabeth.
By Elizabeth, yes. How were they related? Through whom? Or don't you care?
Yes. Elizabeth was the daughter of Henry VIII, and Mary was the granddaughter of Henry VII.
Mary's grandmother...
Yes.
...was a sister of Henry VIII. Would that be right?
No.
Well, let's throw the whole thing out. What's the difference?
Mary was the daughter of James V. And James IV married... Yes. James IV married...
That was the day we got our piano.
The sister of Henry VIII, that's right.
Sir Thomas, you sound as if this were only yesterday to you.
Well, it is with us, you know. 1,000 years in our sight and...
But a day, yes. Who were the prisoners of their uncle? The prisoners of their uncle, Mr. Kieran.
The Henry, Edward V and his younger brother, Richard, who were smothered in the tower by their uncle, Gloucester, who became King Richard III.
That's quite right. That family relationship, Sir Thomas, is correct, isn't it?
Perfectly.
I don't want to have any mistakes in genealogy made on this program. Alice V. McGrath of Providence, Rhode Island, thought this one up. This is about famous uncles of fact or fiction. If I say my uncle, to whom do I refer? Mr. Adams.
A pawnbroker.
A pawnbroker, yes. What does the phrase come from? Why do you say uncle with respect to a pawnbroker?
I have no idea.
Would you like me to tell you?
Yes, sir.
I have it here on a card.
Why?
It's derived from the Latin uncus, U-N-C-U-S, meaning the hook that was used by pawnbrokers to pick up objects. Fascinating, isn't it?
Don't believe a word of it.
It's hard to swallow, isn't it? That's what it says here. Now, Uncle Joe, gentlemen. Uncle Joe means Mr. Kieran?
Uncle Joe Cannon, for many years Speaker of the House.
Yes, and there's another Uncle Joe, Mr. Levant.
Stillwell, or if you're friendly, Stalin?
Yes, I suppose either one. General Joseph Stillwell is often spoken of as Uncle Joe. How about Uncle Charlie? And just to confuse you, Uncle Charlie. Not to be confused with Charlie's aunt, Mr. Adams, just to get you mixed up. Charlie. Uncle Charlie would mean what to anyone, Mr. Adams?
That was in a picture by, that mysterious director who was on our program.
Yes, Mr.
Called, I saw it a million times with the Merry Widow Waltz.
Yeah.
Give me the
Hitchcock.
First.
Hitchcock.
Yeah, Hitchcock.
Yeah, Shadow of a Doubt.
Shadow of a Doubt.
That's right. Very good, Mr. Levant. The one of the chief characters is known as Uncle Charlie.
He is the
part
chief character.
Played by Joseph Cotton. And in sports, Mr. Kieran, isn't there an Uncle Charlie?
Uncle Charlie Moran was a National League umpire.
That's quite
and
right.
And famous football coach of the Praying Colonel.
Good enough. Center that gives us three uncles out of three. How about this? Charles Hughes of Tryon, Georgia, asks a question about... We've had uncles, now we will try wives, briefly. Who are these wives in fact or fiction? The first one helped her husband's political career by altering a speech for him. Mr. Levant.
What Every Woman Knows by Helen Hayes.
Very good.
I mean, by Barry.
Yes. Sir Thomas, you were about to say the same thing.
They all do that.
yes, what was the name of the character?
Kenneth McKenna played the part. He's with MGM now.
What was the, don't give us
Maggie
all that.
Shand.
Maggie Shand.
Maggie Shand.
John
yes.
Shand,
wasn't
it?
To the original. There are people who come before the movie actors, you know.
I saw it in a play. It was called Shandisms. These changes, they became popular.
That's right. Quite right. How about this one? This wife helped her husband's career by founding a symphony orchestra for him. That seems an elaborate way of helping him, Mr. Levant.
Dr. Serge Koussevitzky.
Yes. When was the...
That was before the last war, and his wife gave him an orchestra and built a boat, and he used to go up and down the Volga with his hot six, or whatever it was.
The Koussevitzky hut...